Good evening. I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, and this is the Medical Explorer. As a specialist in skin diseases and allergies, and as host of this program, I will take you on an exploration of the medical communities of our Northern California counties and bring you behind the scenes of medical care practices right here in our local area. Tonight, the Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of our area's only medical facility that specializes in the education and treatment of patients who suffer from diabetes. Our special guest experts will teach us about diabetes and demonstrate new techniques that are now available to treat this chronic condition that affects the regulation of sugar in the human body. In the pharmacy corner tonight, our neighborhood guest pharmacist will bring us up to date on new upcoming changes in the Medicare system that will soon provide payment for prescription medications for senior citizens and those who suffer from some disabilities. Will people over the age of 65 soon have a way of saving costs on prescription drugs courtesy of the U.S. taxpayer? Well, we'll learn the answer to this question and others about the new Medicare drug coverage program in the pharmacy corner tonight. Tonight's program will be extremely timely and informative, and I hope that you'll stay with us for the next half hour. Before getting to our topics tonight, let's take a look at the latest medical news. Macho men and ultra-feminine women are likely to have more severe heart attacks and worse recovery outcomes than less sex-typed people, according to a new study from UCLA. Even when other major heart disease risk factors are controlled, like blood pressure, smoking, and family history, sex roles stand out as a key independent predictor of heart problems. The study found that the more masculine the men were, the more severe their heart attacks, the worse their chest pain after the attack, and the more likely they were to be rehospitalized for heart symptoms within 6 months. Femininity had exactly the same impact on women. The more feminine, the worse off they were. These very masculine men waited longer between first awareness of symptoms and getting help. 7 out of 10 cardiac deaths occur within 4 hours of symptoms. Post-coronary macho men also denied their disease and quickly returned to aggressive lifestyles. The most feminine women were consumed by taking care of others, both before and after attacks. These women tended to suffer extra stress from their social network and then neglect themselves. A virus may cause at least some cases of Alzheimer's disease, according to a new study from Yale University. If the virus theory holds up, it could lead to treatments for the brain disorder affecting 2.5 million people in the United States. Researchers drew white blood cells from 11 relatives of people with Alzheimer's. 2 had early signs themselves. Hamsters injected with cells from 5 patients developed brain changes similar to those found in the rare neurological disorder, which is caused by a virus and could be related to Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's destroys brain cells. Hamsters injected with brain cells from those hamsters also got symptoms. The theory, a virus was passed from human to hamster to hamster. The study doesn't suggest Alzheimer's could be easily transmitted, since genetic factors might determine which carriers actually get Alzheimer's. In some cases, family members have a history of the disease. Women who take estrogen after menopause cut their risk of dying from stroke by about half, according to a new study at USC Medical School. It's the first study to show estrogen prescribed for menopausal symptoms helps protect women from strokes, the third leading cause of USA deaths. The study involved 4,000 women over the age of 44. Hormone users cut their risk of fatal stroke by 47%. Before women encourage their physicians to prescribe estrogen for them, they must weigh the benefits of treatment against its risks. Estrogen cuts LDL, bad cholesterol, while raising HDL, the good type that helps transport blood away from arteries. It also stimulates production of prostaglandins, or hormones that make blood vessels dilate. However, estrogen use after menopause has been linked to endometrial cancer, a fairly rare cancer. My final medical news item concerns the drug TPA. TPA, which is used to stop heart attacks in progress by dissolving blood clots, is being used to improve vision at the Medical College of Wisconsin. In a recent report in the Archives of Ophthalmology, scientists showed that tiny doses of TPA are used in patients whose vision is clouded by fibrin, a blood protein responsible for blood clotting. Fibrin formation can occur after surgery to correct a detached retina. Current methods to treat fibrin formation using steroids and anti-inflammatory agents aren't always successful. After injecting TPA into the eye, the scientists actually saw fibrin dissolve. It's now time for us to visit our pharmacy corner as we learn the latest up-to-date information on the world of drugs and medications from one of our area's most respected neighborhood pharmacists. Returning tonight in the pharmacy corner is registered pharmacist Mr. Bob Church from the Medicine Shop Pharmacy in Marysville. Bob, welcome back to the Medical Explorer.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure having you here. The thought of major changes in the Medicare system always provokes concern about what the federal government has in store for us and our senior citizens. We've briefly heard that there soon may be or are going to be drug benefits in the Medicare program. Will this mean it'll soon be possible for people with Medicare to have their prescriptions paid for by Medicare?
Most definitely. It's actually a part of the catastrophic health care plan that was just passed by Congress. But that provision that deals with prescription drugs will be going into effect in 1990, and it will definitely pay for part of Medicare recipients' prescription bills.
Have your customers been asking about that already?
Our customers have been asking us for probably the last 2 years, not really as to when the law is coming out or when it was going to go into effect, but they're always asking, will my Medicare card pay for my medications? And we've been telling them, well, it doesn't now, but it will soon.
I bet you're not looking forward to all the paperwork implications and all that happening.
Well, I'm sure it'll be something we'll have to deal with.
Yeah, we won't have much choice there.
No.
Will all medications be covered under the plan?
Yes, after a while they will. In 1990, when the program starts, they'll only be covering home health care IV drugs, immunosuppressant drugs for people who have had transplant operations, or anti-cancer drugs. Then in 1991, when the program takes off full bore, it will cover all FDA-approved prescription medications.
What kind of cost is there going to be for patients?
Well, the cost actually is going to be kind of a progressive thing, and it will be a combination between a deductible and a copay. In 1990, when it starts, there'll be a $500 deductible, and after the person has met that $500 out of their pocket, then their future prescriptions, they will pay for 50% of the pharmacy, will bill the federal government for the rest, and then it progresses.
You know, I'm not going to ask you to repeat that, but you're already losing me on all these details. I just can't imagine all the hassles that are going to come up with all of this going on.
Well, I'm sure it's going to happen, but what I think the most confusing thing is the fact that each year the deductible increases and the copay decreases, to where in 1993 the copay will get to be about 20%. The deductible is going to be geared so that approximately 16.8% of the people will exceed the deductible.
So they say 16.8% will be able to use this coverage, essentially.
Right. Now, that's just part of the cost factors. The rest of it is that each month there'll be like a premium payment, which will be paid out of Social Security. And for those folks who have a higher income, they'll be paying a surcharge on part of that, which will be based on the amount of income tax they have to pay.
So essentially, in this case, the senior citizens themselves are going to be paying for this program.
Absolutely.
So it's not the average taxpayer.
That's correct. At least the way that it's set up now. Who knows what will happen 10 years down the line, but the way it's formulated.
U.S. Congress can change that anytime they want to.
They can change it, most definitely.
How in the world, or in the United States, are they going to be able to keep track of these deductibles? I just can't imagine.
Well, the way it's going to happen, it's going to be an expensive proposition. The federal government has to supply hardware and software to all the pharmacies that are going to be participants in this program. So that's going to be an expensive, very, very expensive proposition to begin with. Through the computer setup, whether it's a computer or a point-of-sale black box type of setup, it's all going to be hooked into a central computer, which will check for several things. It'll check for verification of eligibility. It'll check for where the deductible is at that point in time. It'll also handle patient profiles. And I'm not sure exactly what else will be happening because we haven't got any guidelines or any information on that yet.
Any other ideas what other information in general the government might have on their hands with people?
Well, they're definitely going to know exactly what people are doing with their medications. Every single prescription that goes through the system will be going into a computer. They're going to have the biggest drug database in the history of the world.
That's actually somewhat fascinating when you
Well,
think
it is
that.
Because they're going to be able to do all kinds of studies on geographic area, population studies. They'll be able to do cost studies, all kinds of things.
That's right. It's amazing. I'm not saying I'm looking forward to it, but it is
going
to be interesting.
Well, I'm not sure I am either, but it's here.
Bob, it's very useful information, and I hope that our viewers will keep their ears open so that they'll learn about these new systems as they begin. I know that we'll have many more questions for you on these drug benefits of Medicare when they actually begin. And if we're still here on the Medical Explorer, we'll have you back to discuss it.
I think that'd be good.
We look forward to you returning on future programs,
Bob.
Thank you. Now on with the Medical Explorer. Diabetes is a disease that can begin at any age. Even though there's no cure for this chronic condition, there are many new encouraging techniques to assist patients with their treatments. Yuba City area residents are fortunate to have many physicians that are well qualified to care for their condition. However, there's only one center that specializes in diabetes as a full-time specialty. Tonight, we will visit the Diabetes Care Medical Clinic of Yuba City on Lincoln Road. Let's meet internal medicine and neurology specialist, Dr. Jahangir Mahmoudi. Dr. Mahmoudi, it's a pleasure to come back to your facility here in South Yuba City off of Lincoln Road and Highway 99. We've been here on previous Medical Explorer programs looking at your work in the fields of neurology and internal medicine and endocrinology. But today I'm really interested in focusing on the area of diabetes. But before we do that, let's talk a little bit about your background in education. Where did you go to medical school?
Okay, I am a graduate from the Tabriz University Faculty of Medicine in Iran in town called Tabriz in the northeastern part of Iran.
When was that?
And this was in 1968.
68. Mm-hmm.
Yes. And then after that, I was drafted, went to military for 2 years. I was a medical officer, worked in the military hospitals, and then finished the military service in 1970, and then I came to the United States for training.
Where did you get your diabetes training?
Okay, my diabetes training started in 1974 after having completed internship, a year of internship and 2 years of residency in internal medicine back in the East Coast. And then in 84, I was accepted for fellowship at Jahangir Diabetes Foundation, which is affiliated to the Harvard University, and there is a diabetic program there between the Peter Ben Brigham Hospital, Mass General, Women's Hospital.
So you lived in Boston for a while?
Yes.
Oh, I may have run into you there. That's where I went to college.
Harvard,
right.
College.
Right. Interesting.
Yes.
I understand that there is more than one type of diabetes. In medical school, I remember learning about a type of diabetes that occurs in young people, children, another type that occurs in pregnant women, and another type that seems to occur in older people. What goes on in these different types of diabetes?
Well, basically, as I described it, what the diabetes is deficiency of the hormone insulin, or the insulin is ineffective. And basically there are two types of diabetes. One, that old terminology we used to call them juvenile onset diabetes mellitus. And the reason for that, or the cause of that, is that these individuals, the juveniles, usually commonly seen in younger people, they don't have enough insulin in their pancreas. Okay, the second type is the adult onset diabetes mellitus, this is again old terminology. The new term is type 2.
So in these people, they have the insulin, but it's not working well?
That's correct, right. They do have enough insulin, but the problem is that that amount of insulin is ineffective, and the reason is that there is a problem with the peripheral utilization of the insulin, and it's because of the problem with the receptors at the target cell.
Interesting. Now, weight must have something to do with that. If someone's obese, why does that make them more likely to get diabetes?
Okay. Very good question, Bob, because as the body fat increases, the cells get larger, and then there is a loss of the receptors. So the number of the insulin receptors will decrease in their numbers, and therefore the glucose is unable to enter the cell, and so here we have elevation of the blood sugar and the symptoms of the diabetes that develops.
What would be the three most common symptoms that someone who's never had diabetes who suddenly may get it, what would the three most common things they may start suffering from?
Well, the usually, diabetes, the patient, it presents with overt symptoms of diabetes, and the most common overt symptoms is that the patient, they really complain that they're thirsty, that they like to drink gallons of water, they have dry mouth, and they frequently go to the bathroom, and they are hungry, but they lose weight. But they're losing weight.
Interesting, their body can't get that sugar and fat into the cells.
Right, to make the proteins, to synthesize it into the protein and the other structures for the body.
You set up here what you're calling the Diabetes Care Medical Clinic. Is this the name? I'm not even sure. What do you call the facility?
Yeah, we call it Diabetes Care Medical Clinic.
Right, that's what I thought. Yes. What was your goal? What are you trying to accomplish in this facility?
Well, we opened this diabetes clinic about 2 years ago, and the reason was there was a demand for it in this area. A lot of my patients were diabetic with neurological complications, and they were asking me that they needed someone who take care of the diabetic problem. So because of my background training and because of my patients asking and wanted somebody to follow the problems with diabetes, so I felt that this community needs a place for the diabetic patients to go. And our goal here is basically education. Number one, to educate the public, patients, about what diabetes is, how to screen for diabetes, and then what is the right treatment, and then generally to prevent diabetic complication. Because diabetes is the third leading cause of death in this country, and
so more than just having a patient come into a clinic setting and receiving treatment and a prescription and saying goodbye, you're getting involved in the total education and monitoring, and not just treatment.
No, they start a patient coming here first after the initial visit, taking history and examinations, and we put them through a diabetic educational course. It's 6 courses, and we have videotape here, and then they have to, we teach them how to check their blood sugar by the glucometer, various machines, home blood glucose monitoring system, and then they have a log, they have to record their blood sugar, and they're being monitored very closely for the first 2 months, and then followed by follow-up monthly or every 2 months. They get a large exposure to varieties of material.
Well, having such a detailed educational program is really unique in our community, and I think that's where we'd like to go next and actually see how that education is done. Okay. Who's your education director here?
Okay. The education director is my wife, Pamela Mahmoudi. And she is basically the one that instructs the patients about the diabetes and the diet and the different instruments that we use for the checking the blood sugar. And she is in the next room.
Great, let's take a look.
Next
let's do it. Great.
Okay. Next room.
Mrs. Mahmoudi, it's a pleasure to be here in your education facility of the Diabetes Care Medical Clinic of Yuba City. Thank you for letting us come in.
Thank you for coming.
That's a pleasure. Could you begin by telling our viewers about your education in diabetes and healthcare?
Yes, I graduated from Lily Jolly School of Nursing in Houston, Texas. It's affiliated with the Houston Baptist University. And then I got my MS degree from Chapman College here locally, and that's in healthcare administration.
Mm.
And in my background, I've done emergency room supervisory work for 5 years, intensive care nursing for 4 years, and I was assistant director of nurses for 2 years.
I had no idea you had all these years of
right.
education.
So I have a lot more if I...
You have a registered nurse degree then,
right.
and a Master of Science degree in health care administration?
Right.
Fantastic. They may be asking you to take over the government medical system or something like that. I really appreciate the fact that your center focuses on education, because too often I see in the community people going into offices, getting prescriptions, and really not being told what's going on, and I realize that is not the way it's done here. What goes on in your education system here in this diabetes facility?
Well, we have a series of 6 lessons that we give, and we do this. This is free to the patients, no matter what type of payment they're going to be using. And we see them either before or after Dr. Mahmoudi on the visit that same day. In the first lesson, we talk about what is diabetes, and we go into their diet that they're supposed to be on and explain it fully. And then we also go into how to do the home blood glucose monitoring with the Lancets and Lancet device and so forth.
How would a patient who is at home wanting to check his blood sugar do it himself?
Well, it's really easy. It just takes that first time to do it, that first initial stick. That's the worst one, and after that, they seem to do real well. All they need is to have the blood chem strips for glucose, or there's called Visidex tubes, some type of sticks right here that we see. They come in these little bottles of 25 or 50, and after they get, they take a little stick out, they put a drop of blood on it, and they wait the specified length of time. It's different for each one. Then they compare their little stick, the colors, with the amount of the blood sugar here. And usually it only takes like 2 minutes to do the test. So that way they're in charge, I tell them, and they're like the captain of the ship. We're the helpers, and they don't have to run to the doctor's office to get a glucose test or to the hospital.
When I was in medical school, there seemed to be a focusing on testing urine at home. The patients would go in the bathroom, get a urine sample, and test it. That's not really done too much.
No, we don't do any urine testing right now because it takes a while for the kidney to make the urine to fill up the bladder before you feel like you have to urinate, and that can be anywhere from an hour and a half to 4 hours, and that's not telling you what you're doing right at that minute, which is very important. So that's why we do blood glucose testing for all of our patients.
So now, besides that, there's ways now of actually in the home measuring the amount of sugar more than just the strip. They can actually...
Right. They have the different machines available, and I have 4 here that I can show you.
I'd love to see these.
Okay. This one is called the AccuCheck 2, and this is a 2-minute test. It has the little strips that you can use for visual check, too. It's sort of similar to these. And what I like about this is that you can, if the machine doesn't work, you can still compare the colors.
Oh, I see.
But it comes right out here, the test. The next one is called the diet scan. And this is a 90-second test. And what I like about this, it doesn't have to use cotton balls. You can just use Kleenex that you have at home. So it's nothing really unusual.
So would a patient take this little device, which has got a needle on it? Is that how this works?
They can use that. And they can also put it in what I like is these little pins. They stick the little needle in one of the pins. I can show you real quick how to do that. And they take off this little needle cover. And this one you just screw on like this, pop it up, and that's ready to stick your finger.
Gotcha.
And then they push that.
Push right down.
And there's the drop of blood.
So inside here they have the, let's see, I'm opening it properly.
That's fine.
That little needle right there.
And you really don't need the pin. You can just use the little needle, but A lot of people can't take that little lancet and stick their fingers, so we have the pins available. There's
and
a whole bunch of different types.
Those are disposable, types. So
right.
They just throw them away once
right.
they use them.
Right, one time only to prevent infection.
I see. And how would it then the sample be put in the machine?
Okay, they have, each of them have their own little strips, like this one, for instance. They have a little strip that you put the drop of blood in, and then you're going to put it in the machine after you turn it on. Each of them have little different instructions how to mm-hmm. do it. And this also has a little color chart, but it's hard to tell what the blue is color. Anyway, it comes out large, the number, what your blood glucose is, and it also, a lot of these have memory. So if you want to know what your last blood sugars were, you just press the little button, it tells the memory.
Now, this is a real interesting-looking machine.
Right.
It almost looks like a little camera.
Well, this is the newest one. This is called the One Touch by LifeScan. It's sort of an update model of GlucoScan, and it looks like a little Band-Aid, the test strip, and you stick it right in here, put your drop of blood, just dab it right on that little strip, and you close the door. And you don't have to do any wiping or dabbing or anything.
And you can actually see the letters read out here. That's
right, and it tells right what your blood glucose is.
When a patient needs one of these units for home use, is it something that's outrageously expensive? Because I know when we buy these machines for our offices, they're multi-$1,000 units to do these things. And what's happened with prices on these?
Well, what I usually recommend to the patients is to get them when they're having rebates. And they have rebates a couple of times a year, and they can save $50 to $75 on the machine. The machine ranges anywhere from like $100 to $200. So I give them usually about five places that they can buy them, and they call and get the cheapest price. And they use the rebate ticket, and that way the machine only costs between $40 and $60 each.
That's fantastic.
Right. So it's affordable to practically, you know, everybody here in this community.
It's just great that they can do that now and have an accurate following of what's going on with their sugar.
Again, I'd like to thank Dr. Mahmoudi and the staff of the Diabetes Care Medical Clinic for their excellent presentation of their educational and medical care program for diabetic patients. If you have questions about diabetes, you should bring them to the attention of your personal medical doctor or call Dr. Mahmoudi's office for an appointment. Well, that's our program for tonight. I'd like to invite you to write to me at my dermatology and allergy office in Yuba City with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see here on the Medical Explorer. I'm always interested in hearing from you, and I hope that you'll suggest to your medical doctor or other health professional that you'd like to see them here with me on the Medical Explorer. As you know, we are a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the Skin and Allergy Medical Group of Yuba City at 350 Del Norte Avenue, Yuba City 95991. In my next program, the Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of more interesting frontiers of medical care practices in the Yuba City, Marysville, and Stockton areas. Till next time, I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your medical explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight, and have a good evening.